Hey, Sleepy Sheepy here. Today we're going to be looking at a level 80 dexterity build. We're going to be running this with two noble slender straight swords. These are going to be cold infused. For dexterity builds, it's a little bit better to run lightning infused weapons, but you don't get the same status proc that you do with cold infusion, so that's the option that I went. You still get a B scaling in dexterity when you cold infuse, so typically it's associated with either strength or a magic build, but I found that dexterity worked absolutely fine for this, especially at level 80. Speaking of levels, we are going to be putting about 42 into vigor and 40 into dexterity. I recommend those breakpoints and then 28 endurance for the armor that we're going to be using. This is not necessary. You could run something with slightly more efficient armor usage, but I really like the way that this looked, and it gives you a 75 poise breakpoint, which is very solid. You can tank quite a bit with that, and I recommend high poise for a straight sword build. Next, I wanted to go over the different talismans I'm going to be using. So the first one is going to be a flexible one, but for the most part, I'll be using the Rotten Winged Sword Insignia Talisman. This raises your attack power with successive attacks. So if you hit multiple opponents with multiple L1s, that's going to really boost your attack, and that's really helpful. But I do sometimes switch it up to the Blessed Ooze Talisman, which will give you HP over time. This can be useful if you've got a little bit of space and you're low on heals. And then the Shard of Alexander, which boosts your Ashes of War. This is always a good talisman to keep on hand and can be useful if you think you're going to be using more Ashes of War than successive attacks. And then the next one is going to be the Claw Talisman. I would say this is a must use. The jumping attack is so strong with this build, and the Claw Talisman boosts it, so I feel like that's an obvious choice there. And then the Greatjar's arsenal is to manage our equip load here. For this armor setup, I definitely recommend using this one. And then Crimson Amber Medallion is just going to boost HP. This one is optional, but with the damage output in Elden Ring, I recommend making yourself as tanky as possible. You're also going to have a couple options when it comes to the different Ashes of War you can use in this build. So for my offhand, I used Quick Step, and I kept that consistent throughout the invasions. However, for my main hand, I did like to switch this up. So Storm Stomp was the one that I ended on. That one's very solid. It allows you to get a guaranteed L1 attack, which is very strong. So that's a great option, especially if you're being attacked by multiple people. It's just a good way to slow down the fight a little bit, get a quick attack in, or even go for a heal. Another good option is going to be Spinning Slash. This has a similar effect in where you poise break your opponent when you attack them in most cases. So, like Storm Stomp, you'll be able to do some damage and give yourself a second to just regroup, and generally it takes some of the pressure off you. I'll also be using Double Slash. This has the same moveset as the Rivers of Blood Corpse Piler. So you're probably familiar with the timing and spacing required for that. The only difference is going to be that it doesn't have the extra range that Corpse Piler does. So it's a great option. You can use this first phase, second phase, third phase, depending on what you want. The first phase is going to be two slashes, the second phase being three slashes, and then the final phase being just a single slash. So I'll frequently do the first two, and that is usually effective in terms of delivering a status proc or dealing a decent amount of damage. I'm going to be using the Dexterity Knot to boost Dexterity by 10 points, and then the Crimson Bubble Tear to restore my HP when I'm close to death. These are both optional. You could use the Magic Shrouding Tear. That'll boost the magic damage associated with the cold infusion, and then you could also use a Leaden Hard Tear to boost your poise. That might be nice if you want to get out a quick L1 chain and do a whole bunch of damage all at once without your stance being broken. Next, I want to quickly go over the moveset. So the one-handed moveset, it's pretty straightforward. It's mostly just slashes. The running R1 is pretty solid. It comes out pretty quick, and the running L1 is going to be staggered. So in some cases, it can be useful to use the running R1. But in terms of running attack, my favorite is going to be the running R2. This has just a little bit of delay, and I find that when you raise your sword in the first part of the animation, you'll usually get a panic roll, and then there's enough timing to bring it down. So that's pretty nice. The backstep L1 is going to be also a solid option. It's similar to the backstep L1 for a greatsword, so or dual greatswords, that is. So definitely nice there. The rolling and crouching L1 is also pretty good. You get both of your attacks at the same time, which is always useful. And then the L1 chain is mostly double slashes, which is why this is so strong. The jumping L1 is going to be one of the most important parts of this moveset. If you can land both swords hitting at the same time, you're going to do immense damage, especially with the Claw Talisman. You will get both swords having a hitbox on the way down, so if you do jump down somewhere, you will have a hitbox throughout the continued animation, but it's very unlikely that you'll hit with both swords. You're much more likely to hit with just one. One thing to also mention is that the poise damage with the jumping L1 is going to be more than 133, so you're not going to have to worry about not poise breaking your opponent, and you'll always get a stun. This is going to be really important if you're facing somebody with like a colossal weapon or something where it's going to be inconvenient to trade. So knowing which moves you have available to you that'll poise break your opponent is going to be very important. The charged R2 is also going to be one of those moves. So being able to stun lock your opponent for a moment and get in some quick attacks, that's going to be one of the most important parts about using this build successfully. That's all I've got in terms of covering the build information I wanted to go over, so let's go ahead and jump into the invasions. Thank you. If you made it this far, I just wanted to say thanks so much for watching. As always, I really appreciate your support. Watch time, likes, subscribers, these things all really contribute to helping this channel grow, and I do appreciate everyone who's helping out with that. It does mean a lot to me. I'm always on the lookout for different builds to use and different weapons to showcase, so if you have anything you'd like to see, I'd really appreciate you just letting me know in the comments. I'd absolutely be interested in changing up builds and running something new that people like to see. So yeah, feel free to let me know, and as always, thank you.